In this first chapter, we will cover the Notch user interface and how to use the software. I'll teach you how to navigate the 3D viewport and how to use the node graph and the basis of the timeline animation. After this chapter, you'll be ready to start using the tool. Let's start this course by getting a bit more familiar with Notch UI. I will open a blank scene to get us started. I will head to my launcher and go for new project, blank. Notch is now loaded up and I'm greeted with a new project panel. Here I can set some basic parameters for my composition. I can name it, set duration, choose color space, set resolution and frame rate. Here at the bottom I can choose if I want my composition to be isolated or blended. What that means is, do I want my composition to be treated as isolated standalone scene? Or should this and all of the following compositions that I will create in this work file be considered as one big scene and blend so I can go to the timeline and treat every composition as a layer of one big setup? For this workshop, we will keep the default isolated mode. Notch consists of 9 main panels. 5 of them we can see right in front of us. Let's start with the node graph. Notch is a node-based system, so all our designs will be built using nodes and tweaking their parameters. As you can see, we already have one node in our node graph, and this is what we call root node. Think of it as our composition settings. Here you can set custom resolution for your scene, choose its blend mode, enable alpha, and similar. You can move around in the node graph by holding down Alt or by pressing middle mouse key. Ctrl-Alt will allow you to zoom. And alternatively, you can hold Alt and scroll the mouse wheel. Right above the node graph is the viewport. Here you can see all of your designs and interact with your scene elements. If your viewport is blank, I'm sure the viewport guides are turned off. You can enable and disable them by pressing Alt-G. Let's look at the navigation of the viewport. Alt will allow you to rotate, Ctrl-Alt zoom in, panning left-right is done with Shift-Alt and left mouse key, and panning up and down is done with the Shift-Alt right mouse key. Most of the Notch navigation in the viewport is done with the combination of Alt, Ctrl and Shift keys. You will get used to it in no time. Now, if we look at our right-hand side, here in the bottom, we have a retractable panel with nodes. This panel lists out all of the tools and nodes we can combine and manipulate for building our scenes. As you have noticed, all nodes have categories and subcategories that have unique icons and color code. This will help you read node graph easier and faster as you progress with learning Notch. I will find a node called 3D primitive in this list via search and add it to the scene. All I have to do to add it is either select it and hit enter, or drag and drop it. I can even favor it for easy access if I intend to use this node frequently. Right, with this node in the node graph selected, let me highlight the properties panel. Here we can manipulate and alter all of the parameters related to the selected node. And before we move on to a deeper conversation about this node and its properties, let me quickly mention that here at the right-hand side, we have resources. Here is where we can drag and drop all of our external assets, anything from textures to videos to 3D objects and similar. More on that later on when we will start working with video processing and 3D scenes. Now, back to the node in the scene. Most nodes in Notch has 3 points of interest. That would be parenting in the left, output in the right, and inputs in the bottom. Inputs are a variable property. Depending on the node, you might see a bunch of them by default or just one, as in this case with the 3D primitive. So we have a 3D primitive in the scene, but as you see, it's not rendering in our viewport. In order to have this primitive visible, I need to parent it to composition's root node. I can do that by extending a link either from the root or the node parenting handle. I can, of course, unlink the node by pressing Ctrl-Shift and hovering over the link. As soon as it lights up red, I can click on it and the node will be detached. I can toggle node's visibility too. I can do that by hitting Control 1, or I can rename the node by hitting F5. Renaming node might come handy if you are using a bunch of nodes of the same type, like in this case, 3D primitive. I will call this node Sphere. Now I will add another 3D primitive. I can do that by coming back to my node list or by simply pressing Control Space. This opens floating node search, and here I can type in the name of the desired node, so 3D primitive. I will connect this new node to the scene root. I can do that by extending a link or using a shortcut Control R, R for the root. I have two primitives available for me now. However, notice that I can only see one of them. That is because both of the primitives spawned in the center of the scene, and they are overlapping each other. This behavior is standard with most of the things in Notch. Primitives, lights, cameras, all spawn in the center of the graph. So I will mark up the new node and move it aside using the viewport translation handle. As you can see, I can pick elements in the viewport and move them around. Once I pick up another sphere, the appropriate node lights up, and now I'm manipulating the said node. There are more manipulators available for me. They're all accessible here at the top of the viewport. So translation or position, rotation, and scale. I tend to use keyboard shortcuts to access these controls. So E for positional values, R for rotation, and T for scaling. I can scale my primitives by separate axis, or if I go towards the center and all of the handles lights up white, I can scale the object uniformly. So E, R, T are very handy shortcuts for manipulation and placement of your models. Right, for the sake of clarity, I will rename the new primitive to a box by hitting F5 and change its looks. As you see, there is a ton of properties that we can alter in any given node. 3D primitive holds shape type property. And with this dropdown, I can select any of the following primitives. I will make this one into a box. Now I can show exactly why naming our nodes might be handy. Let's say I have a bunch of primitives and the node graph is huge, but I am after a box node. I can search for it by hitting Control F and typing box. As soon as I do that, I will get a dropdown list of nodes befitting the naming convention, and if I hit enter, I will be brought to that said node. Very practical when dealing with huge node graphs. Let's get back to the properties panel of this box primitive. If I move up to the very top of the properties panel, you will see that we have a bracket for transforms. So we're not bound to interactions just in a viewport. We can alter positional, rotation, and scale values of the node in the properties too. You will quickly notice that most of the properties has bounds. So for position here, we have minus 10 to 10. This is an arbitrary range that we can extend if we want to. All we have to do is hold Alt and drag, or if we want this value to change in smaller increments, we can press Control and then drag. Resetting the value can be done here in the center of the slider. In fact, you can reset the whole node or specific tab of your choice by hitting these icons. In between the value and the slider, you will notice a little diamond shape. This right here is our keyframe icon. If I press on it, it lights up green with the green outline indicating that we have a keyframe. And now I can move my timeline cursor a bit further in time to save 5 seconds and change the value. And a new keyframe is automatically added to this position in time and value. If I scrub between those two keyframes, you will notice a change in the icon. So whenever we see an outline on a diamond, we are on the keyframe. And when we don't, we are in between keyframes. I can jump back and forward between keyframes by pressing Control, arrow key left, right. So I will press home now, or if you are using a laptop, you can press FN arrow key left, and I will position my timeline marker to zero position and hit space. This will start playback. And of course, you can use viewport icons here for moving to zero time mark or for initiating a playback. So here we are animating a notch. Great. Notice a small but important detail. Anytime I engage playback, I lose transform manipulators. And that is by design. Because of the real-time nature of the tool, as soon as you start playback, all of those elements are hidden away so you could see your designs better. If you want them back, just hit space, stop the playback, and they are all there for you. So far, we managed to lay down some keyframes. I will add a couple of more on the other primitive. But we haven't had the chance to see them in our timeline. Well, let's address that. Let's press on the second tab here, Timeline. Timeline view by default only shows keyframed or selected nodes. That is by design. Not all nodes are useful to be seen in this view. So for them to appear here, they either have to be keyframed or selected in a node graph. Here, I will make a new primitive. And here is our timeline without selecting the newly made node. And here it is with the new node selected. To make this node permanently visible in the timeline, I can choose to press here on this dropdown and select Enable Time Segment. Or just move it around in the timeline. Or add some keyframes to it. To further filter out specific nodes I want to work with, I can pin them to the timeline. I can do that by pressing shortcut P. As you see, we have a new icon appearing next to the node, and here in the bottom of the viewport, Notch is warning us that we have some pinned nodes. So with this node pinned, I can press on this icon here, show selected or pinned only, and the only nodes that I see now are the ones I've pinned here in the timeline view or in a node graph. This is very practical when you have big scenes, but you need to focus on animating specific node or nodes. While on the subject of working on specific things, here we have range toggle icon. I can enable and disable it here, and I can move around and extend the range. Now, if I was to play back, the scene notch would look specifically to this set range of time, so I could work on perfecting animations in this area. I will disable it for now. Let's take a closer look to our keyframes. As you see, I can move them around in time, select several and copy and paste them. And if I right click on the actual keyframe, I can select its interpolation modes to my liking. Now, if I click on this little dropdown here, I can see exactly what property or properties are keyframed. And if I click on the even smaller dropdown once more, I can see mini curves of the keyframe and manipulate those in time and position. Now, for all the cool kids that likes to tweak and perfect animations to a perfect precision, I would suggest to go to Curves tab. Here we have much more granular control of our keyframes and we can set them exactly to our liking. Keyframing and curve editing can be a course of its own. There is a ton of various handy tools and functions for keyframing and working with curves available for you that I will leave for later, as we still have a vast number of things to get familiar with before we do a deeper dive to this part of the tool. I'm heading back to the node graph. I can actually do that by pressing on this tab here, by pressing F1 button. Shortcuts F1, F2, F3, corresponds with these panels we just briefly discussed. So, before we wrap up our look at the UI, let's check out cameras. Keyboard numeric values 1, 2, 3, 4 corresponds to standard views, top, side, front, all that. 5 is our orbit camera. This is exactly where we are now. Should we want to use a camera in this scene, we need to add a camera node from the node list. So, I will type in camera. And now we have a camera in the scene. As you see, it came into the center of the node graph, so I will just drag it back so the primitives I have in the scene would be in its field of view. And if I hit 0 now, I am in the active rendering camera. I can of course pan around and position it to my liking, but if I want to come back to my working environment or view, I would hit 5. So 5 for orb view and 0 for active rendering camera. You can see your cameras listed here at the top dropdown too. One more practical tip about cameras. If you are in an orb view and you find a position that you would like the camera to be placed at, just right-click on the camera, camera options, and choose set to current view. This is very handy when working with some 3D scenes and trying to find that perfect angle to compose your shot. So this about wraps up the UI chapter. However, you might be thinking, Armin, you mentioned 9 main panels, yet you showed only 7. And you are totally right. Here are 2 we have not looked into yet. So it would be the inspector. This works hand in hand with your resource panel. Here you can scale, trim, prep your files before they land in your node graph. We will be hands-on in this panel once we start working with external files. And next to it, we have a render tab. And that, of course, is where we can render out our designs. I appreciate your patience. We've covered a lot of important things in this chapter. Moving forward, things will get way, way more exciting, as we will be hands-on creating some fun designs. So do grab a cup of coffee or tea and see you in the next chapter, where we will talk about video processing and video effects.